Good afternoon, welcome to Resonance Arcade. It is Wednesday night and we are live. Hello everybody.
Yeah.
As you can see, we've got Steve and Sam with us tonight. We haven't been around for a few weeks. We've all been on holiday, which is good. Which has been awesome, in fact. How was yours, Steve?
Fantastic. Just, obviously, thrilled to be back in the UK.
Yeah, to be fair, I was actually really... I went to Italy, and we went into the countryside in Italy. And although it wasn't as bad as Spain for things like flies, there was mosquitoes at night, and we just got bit to death. So our legs are just scarred with mosquito bites. I was quite glad to get back, personally.
See, I didn't encounter any insects when I was over there. But I suppose I was in a city.
If you're in a city, you're usually all right, yeah, but... because we want the peace and quiet, we don't want to be next to anybody or anything. We had lovely views. It was awesome. And I was glad. The heat as well, too much for me, for my fair skin. I don't like too much heat. Did you go anywhere? You just went to see your family, didn't you, Sam? And me, in fact.
Yeah, I didn't really get a holiday. It was less than a week. It was just like 4 days. I was up.
Still
had it. Comic-Con 2015, yes. Blackpool.
So, yeah, Sam and I went to Comic-Con in Blackpool, but the night we also played some games, which we'll get onto in a little bit, which was quite fun, quite a lot of fun, in fact. Mm. So, for those of you who are new to the show, I'm at a different angle this week because I've now got a fourth monitor above my normal monitor, so I can't put my camera right above my right directing at my face anymore. For those of you who are new to the show, anyway, we do swear a little bit in this show, so please, if you're easily offended, then turn off now. And we are a show about games. We talk about games every Wednesday for a couple of hours, gaming news, games we've played, etc. It's probably going to be quite a games we've played heavy show today because we haven't been on for a while. I think it's been about 3 or 4 weeks, hasn't it, since we were last on?
It's been, yeah, a month, hasn't it?
Maybe about a month, yeah.
I think so.
But anyway, so moving on, let's get straight on to it. So what games have you guys played this month?
I wanted to ask Steve about Mad Max. what's it like? Because I'm curious about it and I was on the fence.
I've been over the buy button on Mad Max a number of times and I'm not sure about it yet.
Well, to be honest, I got it. It was quite cheap, actually. I think it was about £25. But fantastic.
Yeah.
Really, really good.
In what respect? What's good about it? What's
It's fun to play. It's visually very pleasing. Not much story, but it's not really... It doesn't really call for much.
Does it relate to the films in any way?
Very, very loosely. It's set sometime after the latest film, Fury Road, which I can tell you a little bit about, but it'll involve quite a few spoilers.
You
haven't seen the movie.
I kind of do want to see it, so I'm sure the plot isn't massively important, but I don't want it to be spoiled for me either, I guess.
An event happens at the end of the film. This happens after that event.
Okay.
And what you think's finished in the film isn't actually finished.
Alright, so it is somewhat connected to them then.
Yeah.
It's not like a... I thought it was just like a story about Mad Max in an open world kicking the shit out of people with not any... like a side story almost.
Yeah, I mean, there's an aim, but the aim isn't really anything to do with the film apart from it involves some of the same characters and groups.
Are you the main character in the film, or are you a totally different dude entirely?
You play Max.
All right, so, sorry. What a stupid thing to say. What an utterly stupid thing to say.
I think he means, is it modelled after Tom Hardy, and it looks like it's not.
No, it's just the generic...
Not Mel Gibson. Yeah, it's just a generic beard bloke. He probably has the generic voice, doesn't he, as well?
Yeah. I've been looking at this game for a while, and it looks right up my street. However, there's another game I'm playing at the moment that's quite similar. And that's what's made me stop, if you know what I mean, stop buying it.
There's a lot to do, and the world itself is quite expansive. Obviously, it's very kind of like singular terrain. It's like desert and wasteland.
Mm.
There's a few kind of mountains worth of trash, and, you know, canyons and stuff like that. But essentially, where you are is the bottom of an ocean, which is drained away.
Right. Okay. Yeah,
so there's loads of shipwrecks and plane wrecks which can be explored. There's enemy camps, so it's very much kind of like a Far Cry 3 type of setup, where you've got to go and defeat camps in order to liberate areas.
A lot of games are doing that.
Yeah, but it works really well because you don't really have to think about it that much. You can just explore around. And like certain environmental things happen as well, like at random intervals you get just huge sandstorms, and these things look terrifying when they come towards you.
That, to be fair, it sounds exactly like that game that I was just talking about, because that's exactly what happens in this game as well.
We'll get to that.
The sandstorms themselves, as soon as they appear, you can't fast travel anymore. Try and get to shelter. And I've pretty much got my car maxed out at the minute, apart from engines. Like, it's fully armoured, it's got, you know, the best handle and the best wheels and everything, and it can still get the arse ripped out of it within a few seconds in a storm if you're not careful.
So these are like serious sandstorms. Like, you can't be outside in them sandstorms.
Well, you can, but you've just got to be careful. There's like a lot of static electricity around causing massive lightning strikes. It blocks the sun pretty much out. There's huge bits of debris getting thrown around.
It's a big deal when they come then.
Yeah, but there's also benefits in there, because there's a lot of loot to be had. Your main currency in the game is scrap. And there's a hell of a lot of scrap that can be obtained from within the storm.
Okay.
So it's kind of a double-edged sword.
So what is it like mechanically? Like, is the driving nice? Is the combat nice? Like, does it feel good to play?
The combat feels really good. I'm playing with a joypad for like driving, and a keyboard and mouse for fighting.
What's the balance like, the fighting and the driving?
It's pretty good, because there's always a reason to get out of your car. You don't have to get out of your car. You can use your car's onboard weapons to fight people if you want, but it's more satisfying to pound the face in with custom-made knuckle duster made out of big bolts.
What's the combat like? The hand-to-hand? Is it all hand-to-hand, or is the weapon?
There's a few melee weapons, and you do have a shotgun.
Right.
Ammo's relatively scarce, so you generally only use your shotgun when you're either trying to get something at a slight distance, or you just need to. If you're in a big crowd of people and they're all coming at you, and you kill someone with a shotgun at point-blank range, it frightens the rest of them, so they can't hesitate a bit, so that gives you a bit more of an opportunity to get in with your melee.
It sounds very good, in fact. I've heard some negative things about it, but you always hear negative things about new games, don't you?
Well, when I was reading the reviews, it seemed very split. Like, critics and professional reviewers seem to slate it, but the actual gaming community seems to completely love it.
Well, it's usually the gaming community that I have a bit more respect for. No offense to, you know, there's some critics that I do follow, but generally, I don't know, they look for perfection, don't they, in games? And I suppose what they're trying to do is a service to gamers, and they're trying to say, well, this isn't as good because it's taking elements from this game and it's not really doing anything new. Is it doing anything new?
Not really, but it just combines a lot of really good elements from different games in a good way. It's made by the same people who make Just Cause.
Oh, I heard that.
Right, yeah.
And although kind of like the first Just Cause was a little bit clunky and a little bit, you know, unpolished, and they've patched it since and it's a lot better, but the second Just Cause is actually really fun to play, and the grapple you can get on there is like ridiculous.
Yeah. I've heard about that.
So the mechanics are very similar to that when it comes to fighting and driving. I mean, obviously you've got different environments. You're on sand, so you slide around all over the place. But thoroughly entertaining. I mean, I got it about when I got back off holiday, so I've had it about, what was it, just before I went on holiday? Anyway, I've had it about a week or two now, and I've already played 41 hours. So
it looks very good. It I think I'll get it, to be fair.
Video game, the game footage looks pretty good. I think I've got enough to be getting on with for now, but it's probably on my list maybe to get when there's a bit of a shit lull in January next year.
Yeah.
I think I might pick it up then to pass some time. It looks pretty cool. Yeah. It looked cool.
When it came out, I just knew the game. Well, the game I'm talking about is Metal Gear Solid 5, so I might as well bloody get it out of the way and talk about it. Now, me and Sam, obviously big Metal Gear fans. You, Steve, not at all. In fact, probably despise it more than you despise any other game ever.
You're very vocal, despise, but I've just got no inclination to play it at the moment.
Now,
so settle in for a long talk about it.
Now, I can understand that. I can understand what, you know, the problems are with Metal Gear. In fact, I slated it myself when we replayed it through. I'm a big fan. I love it. But Metal Gear Solid 5 is not the same kind of game at all. Metal Gear Solid 5 is very, very much like Mad Max. In fact, it's insanely similar by the looks of it.
Right.
Now, I've been playing it now for maybe 50, 60 hours or something, and I've only bought it literally when I came off holiday, so I've been hammering it quite a lot. I don't know where to start. I really don't.
The one thing I would start with is what you said about it not being like other Metal Gear games. So, this game, it's not got as many of the really weird, ridiculously long cutscenes. Like the intro bit's quite lengthy, but then once you get into the open world bit, it feels like any cutscenes you get are quite few and far between, and it's very gameplay focused. It's just like, get out there and play the game. We're not going to throw 12 hours of story in your face. We're going to throw you into a world. Go out there and enjoy it.
I still don't really know what's going on with the world at the moment, and I like that. I like the fact that I haven't been completely saturated with 50-minute fucking cutscenes, and you know,
I love them, but at the same time, it's refreshing not to have them. Now, a lot of fans of the Metal Gear franchise have been slagging this game off because they wanted that. They wanted, you know, David Hayter back and all the cutscenes that we were used to in Metal Gear Solid 2, 3, 1, 1, 2, 3, and 4. You know, the really long cutscenes, all the long codec calls and everything. All the ridiculous amount of detail that they go into about everything. And this game doesn't really have that. They've gone, no, we're going to make a game that you can lose hundreds of hours in just by playing it. Just go and play the game. And there's a lot of game to enjoy. I've not played a third-person controlled game that feels like I've got this much agency over the character. I feel really in control of him all the time. There are a few moments when he won't quite do what I want, but it feels very much like you're in control at all times, which is a hard thing to quantify. But for a lot of third-person games, they sometimes have very sort of strict animations that make you feel a little bit like you're not controlling him, whereas this, you feel like you're in control of every movement, which I really like.
So, a couple of questions then. This looks open world.
It is.
It is.
It is 100%. And there's multiple different locations. When we say open world, you start in Afghanistan. Bit spoiler here, by the way, if anyone hasn't played it that much. You start in Afghanistan, you then move to Africa. But you've also got your main base of operations called Mother Base, which has been referenced from the very, very beginning of the Metal Gear franchise. This is the Metal Gear game that should have been... we've been waiting for this, if you know what I mean. This is very much an open world kind of Far Cry. We refer to Far. I heard you refer to it, and it's been slated that this is too much like Far Cry as well. A lot of
there are similarities.
A lot of people have criticised that it's not as open world. Sorry, it's not a Metal Gear game because it's open world. A lot of people have slated it because, I mean, the Fulton that you have to use. You use it if you see what I'm doing right now. Is I'm floating in a tank.
A tank with a balloon.
I know it's quite hard to see. I'm trying to change the... unfortunately, XSplit decided to crash on me. So I'm hoping this is still streaming. We might have to stop the stream in a second and start again. Because I can't... I was going to try and change the brightness a little bit so you could see a bit more what's going on. But there's so many things to do in it. And every single time you infiltrate a base, even though you might infiltrate the same base a number of different times for a number of different missions, it feels fresh to me. It feels like I'm approaching it from the first, you know, because there's so many different angles that you can do, and there's so many different ways you can do it. And another thing that I really love about this game, and this is one thing that I haven't really had a problem with Metal Gear for since the beginning, but this game introduces the ability to not be punished for being lethal unless you're playing main missions. So if you're playing the side ops, which you do a lot of, the side operations, you can just be lethal. You can send in your attack helicopter, you can bombard an entire a base with a artillery command, or you can smoke people out, or you can stealth it if you really want to, depending on what you do. And you also have to kind of attack each base slightly differently because of the way that it's laid out.
Yeah.
I am enamoured with this game. It's perfect for me. I can't even describe how perfect it is.
It's very good. And because it's a stealth game, where the stealth weapons, like the non-lethal weapons, feel really good to use, like they're really satisfying. But every now and then, if you want to go lethal, the other weapons are also really good. Like, just being able to cut loose with a machine gun on somebody actually feels really good in this game. There's a good sort of sense of feedback about when you hit the bodies, the animations. The AI on the enemies is really, really, really impressive. Like, they adjust to your tactics. So if you go around doing tranquilizer headshots a lot, then your enemies are going to start wearing helmets more often. If you go around and do all your missions at night, because you can choose when to do your missions, enemies will start to get night vision goggles to see you coming. So the game like adapts to your tactics. If you do loads of snipering from far off, your enemies will start wearing body armor. So the enemy's tactics adjust to your tactics, and you have to then think of new ways to get around them.
It's also extremely customizable as well. It's, you know, like you said about your car in Mad Max, you can customize everything. You get buddies in the game. And I don't know, Sam, have you got the gunsmith yet?
I think I've got one gunsmith, but apparently there's an even better one.
There's a whole range of guns. I did them all at once, yeah. And it was pretty quick. But could you mind me spoiling this? It's not a big spoiler, but...
No, it's fine.
So when you get the gunsmith, and you've got the master gunsmith, you can customise your weapons. So you know that it's going to take you God knows how much GMP and God knows how many resources to get your tranquilised silent sniper rifle.
Mm.
I don't know if you've seen that in your... There's about three of them that you can get.
Yeah, I've got a sniper rifle that's tranquilised, but it's not silenced, and it only zooms in four times, so it's not...
Yeah,
it's so... pretty shit at the moment.
As soon as... But basically, once you've opened... If you see that thing that's on my back, in this, I've got two guns there. I've got a tranquilised and silenced rubber bullet gun, like normal assault rifle, that's it. And then I've also got a sniper rifle that's tranquilized and silent. Because what I've done, once you get to gunsmith, you can mix and match bits from different guns. As long as they fit each other, fit the stock that you're using, you can just mix things. So you don't actually need to buy the top level gun in order to do it. But there's also downsides to it. You know, it reduces Oh, I just broke my leg. It reduces the effectiveness of a gun in some way, but it's still much better than having to wait for God knows how many missions to get your next one.
So is that the sandstorms you were talking about?
Yeah, the sandstorms happen in this. Now at the moment I forgot that, because I was trying to do something really quick in this, I forgot a sandstorm was kicking off. So I full-toned all three of these vehicles while a sandstorm was on. And one of them failed, unfortunately, so I failed the mission. But if you wait until the sandstorm's gone, you get 100% chance of it going.
Yeah.
I've only just found out you can Fulton tanks today.
You have to develop it.
Yeah.
Cargo thing.
I didn't realise.
So another thing we might not have talked about is all the development stuff that you can do. So you have a base, like the mother base, is this sort of like Ulrig private military place that you set up. And you expand it, so every time you do an mission, you get GMP, which is Global Military Profit, I think.
Something like that. It's basically your
credits, your money. And every time you want to expand something, that costs that. Every time you want to develop a weapon, it costs that. So you can, if you extract enemy soldiers or you extract their vehicles and nick things from them, basically, you can either sell them on or use them yourself later. So there's this whole other, like, quite in-depth mini-game of managing Mother Base. And in managing your soldiers and your equipment and setting them out on missions and developing new things. And
now the missions are very much like Assassin's Creed, but to be fair, it's just making a little bit of money on the side. It's a very small part of it. But there's
they're not really intrusive.
You can actually, once you get your combat unit up, you can actually deploy people. I haven't used it yet, but you can deploy other people.
Mm.
Have you tried it? Have you tried deploying any of your combat units as Snake in the main game?
Oh, you mean playing as them? Mm. I haven't tried it yet. I know that you can do it. I might do a few side ops with it because I think it levels them up really effectively.
Right. I've not tried it myself, so I don't know what it does. I thought, well, I'm playing Metal Gear. I want to play as Snake.
yeah, exactly. I wanted to play as Snake as well. You kind of do, don't you? Although it's weird because he doesn't act like him. He doesn't say, he hardly says anything. Mm. Like, people will go through these long speeches and he'll just go, he doesn't go, like, he stopped repeating what people say all the time, like, Snake, you need to exfiltrate. He doesn't do any of that anymore, at all.
But it is Kiefer Sutherland, so.
Yeah, he already knows.
But I think there's more going on here. I'm still convinced that
there's a twist in the tale, isn't there?
Obviously,
there'll be some reason. But what I would say about this game is it's a very, very accomplished open world stealth action game with quite a lot of so many options and ways for you to play. It's the kind of game that I would recommend to people that aren't fans of Metal Gear.
Yeah, 100%.
If you want to play a really cool open world stealth game, really cool controls, in depth like management systems behind it all. So many options, like you can do so many daft things. Like you can throw a load of decoys around and really confuse the guards and just stand around and they won't know which one is the real you, because there'll be these little decoy balloons of you and they'll start shooting them all. So funny.
So whereas Mad Max is completely unstealth.
Yeah.
Mm.
You're driving around in like a big growly V8 and all the enemies have got like war paint over them screaming running at you.
Yeah, Mad Max was not a stealthy guy, from what I remember. That wasn't his deal.
Definitely not his forte.
No.
I could spoof about this all day. It's like when we started playing The Witcher 3, and I was really, really enthusiastic about The Witcher 3 being the best game ever made. This has surpassed it, you know?
They're different. They're apples and oranges to me a little bit. Yeah, like, they're both open-world games, but a very different kind of experience, and they both... can't speak. The experience they're trying to provide, they both excel at providing it for you. Like The Witcher 3 is great at being The Witcher 3. Metal Gear Solid 5 is great at being Metal Gear Solid 5. Now, as I said before, quite a lot of people have gone, this isn't even a Metal Gear game, blah, 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 blah. Like, I haven't encountered many bosses yet. Not really. It's not the iconic boss battles.
Have you encountered the first Metal Gear type thing? Yeah.
So there aren't. The other game was very paced in that there would be set pieces, stage between sneaking sections, and they all did that formula, but you would always move towards some sort of set piece, or a boss battle, or this. We're always moving towards that. Whereas in this, you're just playing the game. You're not being led down a path the same way that you were in the other Metal Gear games. And a lot of the fans have really seem to have got against that. They're going, I wanted Metal Gear Solid 4 again. I wanted the same thing but better. Whereas this is giving you something different. I think it's quite ambitious. It's a very, very different game to all the other games in the series. It is like an evolution, like the next step forward, you know, moving away from trying to emulate movies and trying to be a really fucking immersive giant stealth simulator action game type thing.
I'm fucking terrible at the stealth in Metal Gear. I'm really good at the stealth in this game, and it's the mechanics are, I wouldn't say forgiving, but the mechanics are better designed, I think, in this game. And
yes,
I mean, fair enough, I do get seen. Yeah, I get seen occasionally, but if I want to stealth it, I know how to do it, and I know, as you said, I feel like I'm in control of it. I feel like right now I do this whole section here. It's 20 minutes of me crawling around this tank unit. It's just a side op, but I decided, right, I want to stealth this. I don't want to go in all guns blazing. I do get seen about 25 minutes, about 15 minutes in, but I'm getting quiet to pick off all of the dudes walking around the tank. But there's also a helicopter, which is the first time I've seen a helicopter and a tank together. There's a helicopter circling as well. So
I noticed that.
The helicopter circling, there's a tank in the centre, which obviously you have to... This is before I knew I could fault on tanks as well, because I go up to it and I put loads of C4 on it. But that's the thing. That's a beautiful thing. There's so many different little tools and little things you can do that just make it fun.
Yeah, I mean, the list of... When you look at the list of weapons that you can develop, there's just hundreds. And there's all kinds. There's like, there's like electro mines, there's sleep mines, there's explosive mines. So you can
develop a mine as well.
Yeah, you can develop a mine that when the vehicle goes over it, it just immobilizes the vehicle. Doesn't destroy it, just uses like an electromagnetic, you know, attack. So the vehicle becomes inert and then you can extract it without it being dangerous to you. I love that kind of stuff. It's so good. Like all the different, so many different options and ways to do everything. You can go back and play every mission like 8 different ways which is great. It's really good fun.
You get different, if you do main missions as well, you get different ranks on the main missions. So you get from, I think it goes, I haven't had an E, but I think it goes from E to S. Is S the most you can get?
S is the best rank you can get.
Excuse
me.
Well, I thought it might be S plus as well, so I was trying to
Maybe there is an S plus. That might be if you play it on a hard. I think you have to play the game to unlock the hard mode.
Right.
So maybe that becomes an option then. One thing we should talk about as well, we won't talk about it for the whole show, but another thing that's really cool about it is, Chris mentioned before, quiet. You get buddies that you take in with you. This is one other character that you take with you. The first one that you get, the default one, is the horse, which is really quite a good one. It can do quite a lot of cool things. Obviously, you can get around the map. When you level it up, you can make it take a poo on the road so that any four-wheel drives that go over that will skid, and the drivers will be like put off, and you can then go to
that.
Their car. Yeah, it's cool. It's a really cool thing that I just found out recently. You can upgrade the horse with battle dress so it can get shot at and not get killed. You get this really awesome wolf dog who like sniffs out enemies and tags them for you, and is probably my favourite so far.
He is easily my favourite. I like him more than I like Quiet, and a lot of people love Quiet.
Quiet's it's like a sniper, so she can take out guys and support you, and she's kind of invincible. So you don't have to worry about her.
While we're on Quiet, what the fuck is with those boob physics, by the way?
Yeah, he's been playing a bit of
Dead or Alive.
Dead or Alive, yeah, Dead or Alive.
Oh my,
bikini,
it's horrific.
Bikini volleyball.
She can't. She can't move without both of them going. Come on.
Yeah, they said that she has to. She's sort of like the end. She photosynthesizes, so she can't wear loads of clothes. She has to look like naked all the time. It's like, oh,
that's one thing I was going to bring up as well. What a real lame excuse to make her naked, basically.
That is a bit of a black mark on an otherwise stellar gaming experience. They could have just taken that little bit of misogyny out, and I'd have been like, you know, good. That's more progressive, but no. He still had to have a girl with her boobs out. Kojima! Yeah, and the fourth one is a little mini sort of Metal Gear robot thing that you can pilot, that can, like, you can race around the levels in it, and it's got guns in it, and you can punch people with it and do all kinds of stuff. I haven't played with that one much yet, but that's the last buddy that you get.
You know, it goes really, really fast as well. If you press run,
I haven't played with it yet.
All right, if you press run while you're in it, it goes into like a little mini tank, and you just fly across the scenery.
Awesome.
I didn't know how to stop it though, so I kept smacking into rocks, and I realised you press crouch to stop it instead of back or shift.
Right. Okay.
Sorry, or run. Sorry. What Potatoes just said? What's up with that fox? Now I assume he meant D-Dog. I've customised D-Dog on my game to look like a fox, so he's got a red kind of coat on him.
Yeah, you can do that with the horse. You can change the colour of the horse as well.
I've just got for Quiet. I've just got a skin for her, which intimidates enemies, and it's just blood.
Yeah.
It's blood all over her. She's covered in it.
It's fake blood, but it's the idea is it makes her look scary. But yeah, I mean, story-wise, I don't really know what the fuck's going on, actually. There's been so little information. There's just Cypher, bad guys, secret governments, technology. That's about all I know, really. There's not much else has actually happened, and I've got 26% completed so far. Which I think is overall game completion, not just story completion. But so I've got a long way to go yet. But that is the one thing people have criticised, is the story. But I'm enjoying the gameplay so much that for once, the story of the Metal Gear thing is not what's enticing me. It's the gameplay that's really drawing me along.
Yeah, I mean, I said my main criticism of the when we were playing through them was, it's just there's more sitting and watching than there is game, and it's a game at the end of the day. I understand the interactive movie. I understand, right, give me some interesting story sometimes, but it must, as for a game, for me, it must have more gameplay than anything else.
And this one has that.
It
most
definitely does. And you could just play the game forever without, if you really want to. I mean, if you don't want to wait for side ops to appear, then you could just play the game forever without ever actually doing a mission, if you really want, and not follow the story. Anyway, I think I'm going to have a little bit of a break there because I can't get this stream off. That's why I'm still playing this thing. Hello, everybody, again. Sorry about that. Hopefully, XSplit will not crash again, but we shall see. We shall see. So, we were just talking about Metal Gear Solid 5. I think we've had enough spoofing about that. I don't know if we've convinced Steve to play it or not.
It's one of these things where I can get it for a reasonable price and I'm not playing anything, I probably would consider it, because it looks like it has significantly changed.
It has significantly changed. It's
the
not the same game.
The things that bothered me about the original were, A, just the control mechanism. It seemed very clunky.
It was.
And B, just the complete like story rip. And those two seem to be corrected.
Don't get me wrong. The intro, when we play, when I played through the intro, I was like, what the fuck? What the fuck are you doing? Kojima again, because it was like flaming a guy on a flaming horse chasing you through the Afghanistan, chasing you out of a hospital.
Yeah, I think you're in Greece at that point.
You're in Greece, right? But and it's like, and then this kind of psycho mantis red haired girl floating around. Okay, what the fuck? Still no idea. They're Cypher, I assume by now. I think they are Cypher, but that's all I know really.
The intro is it's weird because the rest of the game is so unlike the intro that it seems like, why did you make this really like weird and quite off-putting intro? Yeah. The intro tested my patience a bit. I was like, right, can we just fucking get... I get it. It's weird and scary. Can we just get this over with now? Because I know what the rest of the game is supposed to be like. And yeah. I'm like, can I just get to that now? Like, I'd actually just want to get past this bit. And it went on a bit longer, so you have to get through that intro. Which, to be fair, is probably about an hour's worth of gameplay if you don't die during it.
Is it? Is it that long?
I think maybe about that, is it? Because there are cutscenes, and the other stuff at the hospital is quite slow-paced.
I suppose, yeah, including all of that. Yeah, I see what you mean.
As in, from starting the game to getting into the open world Afghanistan bit, it's probably about an hour.
Yeah.
And then once you get to that, it's like, like a breath of fresh air. You've got this whole like open world game to enjoy, and it's really cool.
Now I won't even mind longer cutscenes later on in the game, as long as they remain with the open world gameplay and it remains interesting. I'm hoping there's more than just the two areas as well.
So Africa and Afghanistan.
Yeah, I think I'm about 30% in. I think I've done about 29-28% now.
I don't think there are more than two open areas.
I mean, don't get me wrong, there's still plenty to do in both of them. I mean, I've seen most of Afghanistan, but I think I'm going to have to go back there because there's at least one or two areas that are they're locked at the moment and I can't get to.
I think you do revisit quite a few places just in different ways. Obviously, your side ops go back to a lot of those places, and I think the main missions will help you do different things in those places as well.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of interiors, but I don't really mind too much.
No, there's a few bits, but yeah, I don't mind that either. Right, shall we move on then?
Anyway.
Shall we move on?
Yeah.
Have you played anything else, Steve?
See, it's been that long now, I can't remember what I'd played on before the last show and what I've played since. I have got a few games that I haven't had a chance to play yet. I finally bought Satellite Rain, which is that indie kind of Syndicate remake.
Is that out? I didn't think that was out yet.
Yeah, it's been out for a while, but it's always been really highly priced. Been like £20 plus. I've got that, but I haven't actually... I've installed it and I've turned it on to make sure it works, but I haven't heard it. Don't think there's anything else.
Sorry, I'm just pimping the show to somebody who may very well watch in a few minutes. Yeah, Satellite Rain looks interesting. It's a turn-based strategy, isn't it?
Yeah.
What's it like?
The intro looks okay.
Okay, right. You haven't played then yet.
No. It's one of these things where, like, in order to play it, you're gonna have to get used to the mechanics, so you need to put a good few hours into it.
Yeah,
to start
yourself
off.
Well, I think it's on my list. It's on my wish list at the moment, and I'm going to get that at some point. Shall we talk about what we did after the Comic-Con, Sam?
Yeah, we played.
So you
want
to talk about that in public?
Well, we did quite a few things that we're not particularly proud of.
Gaming-related.
Yeah, gaming-related. One of which was played Cards Against Humanity, it was... I bought it when I was at the Comic-Con. I got speaking to some guys at some of the game, you know, the card game and board game stores. And I saw it and I was like, oh, I want that. So I thought I'd treat myself. It's like 10 quid more than I could have got it for online, but I thought, you know what, if I've gone to an event, yeah, exactly. Anyway, bought it, thoroughly enjoyed it so much that I had to go out and get extra beer so I could get a little bit more pissed to play it.
It was good.
Some of the things that come out of that, brilliant.
Just brilliant. I mean, the more unpleasant and offensive you can be, that game usually the better.
Hmm.
Hence the title, Cards Against Humanity.
Yeah, but we also before we settled into playing that, we got my old SNES out and Mega Drive.
Yeah,
they were the only two, weren't they?
Just the SNES and the Mega Drive. It did talk about something on the Atari, but I don't think we actually played anything.
No, we didn't. Well, we got the SNES out originally because I bought Chrono Trigger. Now, I got it expecting it to work with my Action Replay 2 on the SNES.
Is it a Japanese version?
It's a Japanese version. Right. Anyway, I got it out expecting it to work and plugged it in. Didn't know how to use my Action Replay, basically, and plugged it in the wrong slot and didn't know. Well, I didn't plug it in the right. I put it in the right slot, but you have to put a. I've always wondered since I was a child, since I got it, what the two slots were for.
Yeah.
And what you do with an Action Replay 2, specifically for a SNES, is you put the game you want to play in the top, so the Jap cart or the NTSC cart, and then a normal PAL cart in the back, any PAL cart, and it'll work. Now, because my SNES is a bit dodgy, even though I did probably try that at some point, it sometimes doesn't turn on, so you have to, you know, do the magic blow and turn the switch on and off a few million times before it comes on. And anyway, I tried it again after Sam... left, and it did work, but I forgot that it's a Jap cart.
I was going to say, so it must be quite hard playing the Japanese version of Chrono Trigger.
Well, I started playing it, and I thought, you know what? Shall I just not? I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to stick it on eBay, and I'm going to try and get the NTSC version. Now I know I can play NTSC carts.
Yeah. Well, I was thinking, if it is all the text in Japanese as well. So you can't really enjoy the game, can you, at any level?
It looks brilliant, though. I mean, it's got a really nice look to it. It's got that old, you know, the old SNES top-down Link, like Zelda-type top-down.
Isometric, I guess they call that.
It is like Link. It's kind of like top-down, but everything falling over.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah,
well, okay. Like most, like
all classic RPGs,
like the original Metal Gear and all that kind of stuff.
I'm curious as to why you want the NTSC version, not the PAL version.
You can't get a PAL version of Chrono Trigger.
Yeah, you can. I've got one.
Or you can get one. You can get one on the GameCube.
You can get the SNES version.
Advance.
I've got Chrono Trigger PAL for the SNES.
Are you absolutely sure?
I am absolutely positive.
I don't believe you because I'm pretty sure that I've looked for it. And I've been told that you can only get a Jap and an NTSC version.
There's an PAL English Chrono Trigger for the SNES on eBay for £33.33 at the minute.
PAL. Oh, there you go.
There's another one for £110.
Right, okay. So there were two games that I wanted for my SNES. One was Chrono Trigger and one was Secret of Mana. And one of them you could
Secret get. Of Mana you can't get in PAL.
No, you can because I've got it.
Can you?
Yeah, I bought it. I paid like £30 for it or something on eBay. I've got it. I'm sure Chrono Trigger you can't. I'm not going to start looking it up, but I could have swore that that's why when I saw it and it was £8 and I was like, oh, I'll get it. And I'm a dickhead. I should have just left it.
You can even get the that dodgy sequel that they released, Chrono Trigger Echoes.
Is that not as good?
This one they're selling on eBay is genuine.
Oh, I'm sorry. Why is it so rare? Ah, maybe that's what it was then. Maybe it was just really expensive, the ones I
it
saw
is
on eBay.
Very expensive. I only got my copy because I was working in chips at the time. Because it was a franchise, all the franchisees had to send back their second-hand bought-in games. And I worked in the warehouse. So I was like, I'm having that.
Yep. Bit of the old five-figure discount.
No, I paid for it.
Alright, okay.
But I got like first dibs because it would have flown through the door, that thing.
It's quite a sought-after SNES game, isn't it?
It is very, yeah.
Did you see the link I pasted in the Skype for us?
I can't.
Alright.
Have they released like a downloadable version on the... you know, on the Wii or anything like that, or the Wii U that you
can get it on the 3DS.
The game was never released in PAL territories before the Nintendo DS version. You've got it for the. You told me that you got it for the DS, not the Advantage, the Advance.
Ah, I've got it for the 3DS as well.
3DS, that was it.
Just the DS. Says the DS one.
Yeah, yeah. I knew that. I knew that it existed on the DS. I think you're lying.
So, if they've re-released this game a few times, why haven't they ever done a full-fledged follow-up to it?
They tried to. There was one called Chrono Cross that was released for the PlayStation.
Okay. Did it just not translate well to 3D or something, or was it like a...
No, it just lost its magic, to be honest.
Yeah, is it the same development team? Have they all gone on to do different things?
No. It was Square that made the original, I think.
Yeah, I thought it was a Square game. But the Square don't make games the way they used to now, do they? So
No.
Their RPGs aren't like their old-school JRPGs, are they? They're totally different now. Which is why I think some people are worried about the Final Fantasy VII remake, because it isn't going to be remade by the original team, it's going to be remade by new guys who don't make Final Fantasy VII type games at all.
Right. I don't believe you. I officially don't believe that you can get it for the PAL, because I looked it up considerably. I can't, there's a few on eBay, you're right, but I think they might be fake.
Well,
there's quite a few on eBay, actually. But
yeah.
Anyway, it doesn't matter. Whatever. If someone can tell us if it's available for the PAL, then I'll probably get it at some point, because I really was under the impression it wasn't. If not, I'll get the NTSC version, because at least I know that I can convert it, so it's not like a problem. Moving on.
Anyway.
So we also played some Street Fighter 2, and Sam kicked the living shit out of me on it, which was a bit upsetting, I have to be honest with you.
It was such a cool little nostalgia trip. Every time I play Street Fighter 2, it's like, it just reminds me of being a kid so much.
I say kick the living shit out of me. You beat me on most of them, but I think I got you once or twice.
Quite a few rounds. They were quite quick. I definitely won more than I lost.
Yeah, you did. We also went down the Super Mario Brothers route, and we played the original Super Mario Brothers remake on the Super Mario All-Stars. So it was the Super Mario 3 graphics for Super Mario Brothers.
Yeah.
So it's not the original blocky NES graphics, and that was on the SNES. And we played Super Mario 3, and Sam hadn't played anything before, and I kicked the living shit out of him on those, even though it wasn't really a competition.
I was, because you were playing Mario and I was playing Luigi, and you do take turn level sort of thing. But I just was like hopelessly inept at that game, like not judging the jumps right.
What does the mushroom do? Speed.
Yeah, except nearly that bad. What, falling on that kill? Yeah.
Oh, how did you pick that up then? And then
will kill you.
Yeah. How did you pick up that shell? That was
only
it,
three
though,
buttons
for the SNES. That was it. We didn't play. Oh, I put Metal Marines in briefly just to see if it was two player, but it wasn't, unfortunately.
Yeah.
We moved on to the Mega Drive after that because we got our nostalgia on and wanted to have a play. Thought Road Rash was two-player. It is two-player, but it's two-player one after the other, which is completely pointless. So
I think Road Rash 2 was split-screen.
And the frames per second on it as well, my God.
It's awful. Not aged well.
It was worse. It was worse than like Boogie Boy on the Commodore 64. It was awful. Streets of Rage 2, we played quite a lot of that. I was a bit bored of it, I have to be honest, after a while.
I think we played through till we used our continues up, but it is just a walk to the right and punch people game.
And again, like, I thought you were well beating me on that, but you died and I still had like two whole continues left or something. So I just gave up at the end. I thought, I can't be asked playing on my own.
I started out doing better than you, and then I started to get really shit for some reason.
I think I prefer Final Fight, you know, from Streets of Rage. From
Final Fight felt like it had better controls than Streets of Rage, from what I remember.
Better characters as well.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, nice.
There was more variety, I think. There was like three, wasn't there, in Final Fight, but they felt really different.
And then we had the good old single-screen Micro Machines. What was it? Micro Machines Turbo Tournament on the...
Which is
Mega
class.
You know what?
I forgot how much I love that game. I used to fucking play that game so much when I was a kid.
I had it on the NES. I had that, you know, the expansion cartridges that you had on NES. That I think Dizzy was one as well. I've got Dizzy downstairs. You had to plug another cart into it and then plug it into the NES in order for it to work. And I think I actually prefer the NES version of it, I have to be honest with you. But we were quite even on that. I was surprised.
That was more even, that one.
I was surprised, but I mean, you started out destroying me, and then I just got quite a few sneaky wins in there, and then you just beat me towards the end as well.
What I like about that game is it's such a simple premise and a control system that, yeah, it only takes a few minutes to get into it, and then you just start fighting dirty, pushing each other off the... Because obviously all the tracks are like rulers on a table and bits of orange and stuff, and you just push each other off as much as possible.
So was this the one with the cartridge and the two controller parts at the top? Was that
Yes, because you could play four player, couldn't you?
Yeah, you could. Me and Lou used to hammer that game.
So good back in the day. Like, I used to play that a lot.
It's one of those things where it was massively frustrating as well, because you could be doing, like, you could be driving perfectly, and someone just nudges you at the wrong point, and you hit the corner of a ruler, and you bounce, and you... and you're back at the back.
You're like, come on! Yeah, I remember. I remember I 100%ed that game, and used to play against my sisters, and then would beat them, and they didn't want to play me anymore.
The fast cars are the worst. I liked the really slow trucks, because you could at least know where you're going. Look at this guy!
You have to memorize the track.
Yeah, you got to know the track.
You end up memorizing the tracks after a while. I mean, I did. As we were playing it, I was like, oh, I remember this one, because it's been like 12 years or something since I'd even looked at it.
I was definitely more familiar with the NES one, though, because even though it was a similar kind of control system and similar basis, it was still very... The tracks were all very different on the NES, so I know those ones, but I didn't, in fact, know any of the tracks on this.
I had the... I think it was V3 was the one on the PlayStation, which was the same principle as this, but it just had 3D models, and that was awesome as well. These games, back in the day, the Micro Machines games, were a big deal. Like, it felt like everybody had one of them, and you would always play it at your mate's house, or they would always play it if they came to yours.
It was kind of like the Lego franchise these days. It was just the game that every kid had.
Yeah, yeah. But I guess the Lego games these days, there's a Lego for everything. Like, you can have a Lego Star Wars or a Lego Harry Potter or a Lego Batman. Like, whatever your kid is into, get the Lego version of that and stick them in front of it for a while and they'll shut up.
It's impossible to play it that well, this guy. This guy's a knobhead.
Oh, I don't remember that level. That must be
not
from Turbo Tournament. That's from somewhere else.
Oh, well, they're all similar, though, aren't they? I mean,
yeah. That's
just Micro Machines 2, I think.
Ah, right, okay. I don't think I had that one. I only had one. I had Turbo Tournament, which was the one I had, but I played it to death. That was cool, though. Those played on Street Fighter 2 and that made me want to get a SNES.
Mm.
I'd love to get this game again. I'd have no one to play it with. I'd just play the one player, but Street Fighter 2, such a good fun game.
It's not just Street Fighter 2. I mean, Street Fighter 2 is pretty expensive now as well. You can't get it particularly cheap. But we played this one.
Yeah, I did nothing, but only two player.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Oh, no, we've lost Sam, unfortunately.
Yeah, that's all just went in really a bit...
Anyway, sorry, Sam, you know, shush, can't hear you. So let's move on slightly. God, I've played loads of other games. Hopefully we haven't lost Sam entirely, but we'll find that out in a minute. So I played a little bit more of the Stanley Parable. Have you played that, Steve?
I've got it, yeah, and I've played it for a couple of hours, but I don't know, once you've kind of done it a couple of hours and you get the premise of it, it kind of... Well, I don't know, it's moved on to other things, I suppose.
Well, that's it. It is only a few hours worth of games, game. Now, I've played it for a few hours myself before, but I got my wife to play it, and... I sat her down with my laptop and I said, I'm not telling you anything about this game, just play it. And she was utterly baffled of what was going on. She had no idea, because it was really interesting that when I played it for the first time and it says go through the left door, I immediately went for the right door.
Yeah.
What did you do?
I think I went for the right as well.
And did you go against everything that the narrator said at least the first time?
Well, the first time I played it was after I watched Lou do it. So I think he went against everything, so I kind of went 50-50. I kept mixing it up.
Right, yeah. I mixed it up. I mean, that's the whole point of it eventually. But there's not as many endings as I thought there were. And I think apart from maybe one or two, me and my wife got them all the other night. Anyway, it took her a little bit. It took her about an hour to get her head around it and figure out what was going on. But once she did, she really, really enjoyed it, and she really, really wanted to keep playing it the night after, which I didn't. She's never usually like that with those kind of games, at least. Anyway, yeah, played that a little bit more. Have you heard of the Stanley Parable, Sam?
Yeah, I actually played it at yours. Not the last time I came, but I think it was at Christmas or something when I came over. And I played a little bit of it. And I did, the first time I did it, I did exactly what you said. Everything the narrator said, I did the exact opposite. And then he was like, you get to the end and he's like, well, you clearly don't want to take part in this game, do you? And just sort of like ends the game there, doesn't he?
I thought it was really interesting that my wife followed everything the narrator said because she thought she was going to do something wrong. She thought that she was going to be told off. Or
do you think that's an experience thing, though? Because we've talked about this before, how in any given situation, Dead Space is a good example of a game that does this. You have this little thing when you're doing your mission and you just sort of go boom, and it sends a little line out where you're supposed to go. So if ever I get to a corridor, the little line goes to the right. I always go to the left because I want to see what's not on the path that's been laid out for me. Yeah. What else does the game have to offer? So the Stanley Parable says go left. I'm like, well, I obviously want to go right to see the other path. I will come back to the main path later. You always know I'm going to do that at some point.
Yeah,
not rejecting it entirely. I'm just not doing it yet. I'm doing this other thing first to see if I can find something else. I think that's like an experience thing. Us guys have played games since we were like fucking 5 years old or whatever. It's now ingrained in us to think that way.
Even if it's just like go down a little nook or a cranny, you know, while you're walking along a main road, you want to see what's underneath the staircase, or, you know, it's inside the box. You know, it's not on your main path. And I did sit and explain. Well, I'd had a conversation with my wife about that, and I said, well, why did you do that? Why did you? And she said it was because she was told to. She said that it was because the narrator said Stanley went through the left door, and I was like, well, did you not want maybe to see what was going on in the right door? You had a choice. No, but the narrator told me to go left. To me, that's absolute madness. It's really interesting, though, that because she doesn't play games as much. She's played Atari games, and she used to be into she played Half-Life a little bit when that came out with previous boyfriends and things like that, but it's still really, I found that really, really interesting. Like a psychologist would have a field day with my wife, you know, just analysing the thought patterns and the difference, I suppose, between me and her, especially how we play games anyway.
Well, we've probably talked about this before, but a game that I thought really did a similar thing to what the Stanley Parable did was Bioshock, the first Bioshock, with the whole... Now, I know we haven't done a spoiler thing, but honestly, anybody watching this, if you've not at least played enough of Bioshock to know the general gist of the story, then sorry, but I'm about to spoil it for you. Spoiler warning. But yeah, everything you're told to do, you got the phrase, would you kindly, attached to it. So as a gamer, you've got the little arrow telling you where to go. Would you kindly go and, get through the first level of the game and kill a big daddy for me? And you go, oh, yeah, I kind of do want to do that. And you go and do it. They play on that everything that you've been doing in the game, your character has been suggested because it's a trigger phrase that your character has to do those things, has no choice about it. But you're controlling an avatar, you're controlling a character yourself, but you've done all those things too. So that was a good game that made you sort of go, oh, like that feeling when you confront Andrew Ryan and he says a slave obeys, and you, that moment, probably made everybody feel a bit weird, like that you've been going through this game and really enjoying it, but you've been doing it. You know you've been doing jumping through hoops, but the fact that the game openly says you've been jumping through hoops makes you feel weird and a little bit like betrayed, a little bit almost. Like, what if I'd not done that then?
It's on the list to replay with the wife, because I think she'd really enjoy the story in that, and plus it's quite scary and eerie. And she likes that kind of. that kind of game, especially watching them. And she's useless at playing them, God bless her, because she just hands the controls over to me as soon as something scary happens or she can't get past a particular bit, you know.
The first Bioshock's got a lot of really creepy moments in it.
Yeah.
The slicers.
The Houdini splicer, when you first encounter that, and you see the shadow in front of you, and you turn around and he's there, and then he like disappears, and you're like, oh god!
No!
And you're in a tiny little corridor, and it's like, don't hit me, please. Yeah.
Speaking of slightly scary, psychological, kind of horror-ish exploration games, let's say. Among the Sleep, I've had a play of. I think you... Did you see any of this, Sam? Because I was playing it when you came over.
I have, and I've also seen bits of it because I thought I've heard of the game and looked into it because it looks interesting to me. So I know the general gist of what the game is about.
Have you heard of it, Steve?
Yeah, I'm just looking it up now.
Unfortunately, XSplit's crashed again, so I can't show a video of it, but at least you can see us now. Among the Sleep is an exploration game where you play as a baby. You play as a toddler, a two-year-old, rather. And your mum puts you to bed at the very beginning of the game, and through the entire game, it's quite old now, it's at least a few years old. Through the entire game, it's basically you seeing the world through the eyes of a baby, and it does a very good job of it. I think it's won awards and things like that. It's an indie game. It's one of those, it's an exploration game where not very much happens. There's not much peril. There's a few moments that you can die, or you can have an end game on it, but even those moments are part of the game. They do quite a good... It's very eerie, you know? Mm. You're walking through it, and there's a whole point to it at the end, and it was one of those games at the end where it's a slightly ambiguous in that when I've looked up what the actual meaning was, because I had my own ideas about how it ended, everybody on the internet is arguing about what the ending is, you know? Why it happens a particular way. If you don't like exploration games such as Gone Home, Dear Esther, Stanley Parable, that kind of thing, then you won't enjoy Among the Sleep because it's very similar. And it's one thing I liked about it, it's the only game I've ever played where you crawl faster than you walk. And that's a very simple thing, but it's a nice... It's weird because, I mean, I was naturally... Every time if you run forward... I think you can run faster than you can crawl, but you can only run for a certain amount of time because you're a toddler and you fall over onto your hands and knees. And every time I fell over, naturally I'm standing up and running. And then I realised about maybe 20, 30 minutes into the game, hang on, I am crawling fast. It even tells you at the beginning of the game that you crawl faster than you walk, but I just didn't pay any attention to it. Naturally, the gamer in me said, get up, run, but no. It's better not to. Anyway, I won't spoil the ending for it, just in case anybody does want to play it. But it's worth it if you like your explorations, and it's got a very unique way of telling a particular type of story. And it's a little bit shocking as well, the end. It's a little bit, oh, I didn't expect that.
Mm.
Good. And I also played Grim Fandango Remastered, which you've played, haven't you, Sam?
Yeah, I played it, completed it. I really enjoyed it.
Steve, you've played the original, I assume?
The original, yeah.
I'd never played the original. I played the original recently. I think I got it on GOG free, I think. They were offering it free or something, or it was a demo, something like that. And I didn't really get on with the tank controls, but thank God they've added point and click, and they've also added camera relative controls as well, so... A combination of those two, I can actually play. Quite enjoy playing it. Bit stuck, and I'm not too far into it because it's one of those, you know, action Monkey Island type adventure games where use everything on everything until something works. You know.
Yeah, some of the solutions are really obscure.
Convoluted.
To what I remember.
Is that the word for it? Yeah. I know there's one thing, and to be fair, Sal's looked up what we have to do next. So on Friday when we play it again, we'll. I know what the next step is at least, but after that I've still no real idea. But yeah, I'm quite enjoying it, and I like the fact that you can flip between the old school and the new school graphics.
Yeah, I quite like that.
Although,
they're the same models, but they've just got better textures, basically.
It's the same backgrounds, from what
I can tell. Yeah, the character models are the only ones that are different.
They are new models entirely. They redid the models, and they redid, obviously, the textures on the models, because there's a few... I watched... Tim Schafer. Yeah, what's his name?
That's the guy.
Sorry, Mr. American dude, but
I'd say Schafer.
Yeah, Schafer. I thought. Yeah, I watched his playthrough because he's been doing quite a lot of devs play their own games. He's been doing quite a few of those, and I watched a few of them, and he was going through each scene, and he was pointing at certain things and going, oh, I remember this bit when we animated this guy. There's a bit of his cheek that comes through his teeth when he's talking, and we really wanted to sort that out, so we had to redo the entire model, you know, that kind of thing. So they've done quite a lot to it to remaster it, but the, you know, everything has to be higher resolution anyway, etc. So, but yeah, I'm enjoying it so far. It's just one of them. I've decided to, again, probably wouldn't play it if I wasn't playing it with the wife, because it's a little bit older now, but still enjoying it.
I've considered downloading it, but I've been disappointed with remakes in the past, and I've got fond memories of Grim Fandango, and I don't really want to spoil it.
It's exactly the same.
I really enjoyed it.
Go on.
I was going to say, I'd never played the original before, but I really liked it. It's basically exactly the same, except that they give you a slightly different control option, but you still use the old control option, and the character models are updated. The backgrounds are already nice anyway. They just made the backgrounds like high def, so it's still the same painted, but it plays, I think, as far as I'm aware, exactly the same as the old one. The story is exactly the same. It's the same voice acting. It's all the same. It's just updated.
It was up until 11th of September, which is now 2 weeks ago. I put this in document a while back. It was 55% off on Steam, so I imagine on some of the unmentionable sites, you should probably be able to get it for. I think it was like £3 or something, and I thought, oh, I'll have that while it's cheap. Because again, it's been on my list for a long time, but I just haven't got around to it. Okay, so lastly, but not leastly, The Witcher 3 finally completed it, and this was a few weeks back. Has anyone else completed it yet? I know, Sam, you put it down, didn't you?
Yeah, I purposefully stopped playing it until the DLC comes out, and I'm gonna pump through that and finish the game.
Okay, well, which DLC? Because the DLC's for, isn't that a whole new area of the game?
Yeah, but I'd kind of like to have to be able to finish off a few missions in the original areas as well.
Well, the DLC, if you care that much, you know that the latest patch, I can't remember what version it is, but the latest patch released a new game plus. So you start the character, you start the game with your character at least level 30 or more if you've got a higher level character than that, and then you can play the DLC with that particular bit and go all the way through the game again if you really want. I loved The Witcher. The ending I really enjoyed. It was really good, really well put together, and really satisfying to complete it.
There are different endings, you know.
I was going to say, I've heard there are different endings.
That's quite a feature in all of Witcher games. Depending on the character interactions and the people that live and the people that die, depends whether or not you get like a happy ending or a sad ending or a...
Well, I got a happy end. It was definitely happy, the one I got. I mean, you know, you could have looked at some things that happened as a bit, oh, could have probably been better than that, but I really enjoyed the whole ending sequence, because there's a whole section that you probably haven't even played yet, I imagine, that's set in other places, and that's all I'll say for now. And it's really interesting, and it's really really well done, I thought. And the final battles and the final bosses and all that kind of thing, they're all really well done and different enough between them to, you know, I really enjoyed it. And but I've had my fill now, I think. I don't think I'll bother with the DLC, even though a few weeks, months back, I was saying I'm going to buy every single bit of DLC and I'm going to play it to death. And
You could come back to it. Like I say, I think once Fallout 4 is out of the way, that's the last. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that's the last really big one this year. Potentially Star Wars Battlefront, but
well, it's getting a lot of bad press now. Battlefront, isn't it?
It has been getting some. So but I think after that, there's going to be a few months where I reckon I might go back. I want to finish it. I might go back and do the DLC, you know, January, February, if I've not got much else on at the time. I like to go back to games and sort of give them another go around if it's a bit of a shit time of year.
I usually have
to revisit them.
I usually find that when I do revisit a game, because I know most things about it, unless it's been a long time since I played it, I'll kind of rush my way through the bits that I know and get everything that I possibly can, and then I'll just go, oh, I'm a bit bored now. And I never really complete them again the second time through. It's just me, but...
I've played most of my favourite games, I've played through to completion several times and enjoyed the full experience of starting from beginning to end. Like, if I revisit a game and I've got an old save file with loads of cool shit, I will go back to where I started the game with nothing save file and work my way up from the bottom again.
Same.
For that experience, I always do that. And I like to get to the end credits again and then put it down again and go, I've done that game now for the third time or whatever, and put it away for another couple of years or whatever.
I've done that with a few games, don't get me wrong. Final Fantasy VII, I've played that God knows how many times, I've lost count. Played it so much I've bloody perfected how to complete it, you know. Metal Gear 1, I've played that through a number of times. Can't think of any others off the top of my head. Quake 2, don't know why, every now and again I really really just want to start Quake 2 up and bunny hop my way through the entire level, rocket jumping past things that I shouldn't be rocket jumping, just speed running it basically, not professionally obviously because I'm not that good, but
in the one player game,
it's shit, it's fucking awful, but I'd still sometimes start it up and just go for 20 minutes or however long it takes me to complete it, and then if I do get bored at some point, I'll just open up the console and type map space not map boss 2 and that's it, or boss 1, whatever it is, and then I'll just go and complete, like kill the end boss, and then that'll be me done, I'm happy.
There are certain games that I'll play through a few times just because I really enjoy the story of them. Like, I've played through the Legacy of Kain series a few times where I've started at Soul Reaver and gone through to Defiance as a 3-game arc and then enjoyed that. Like, God, that was cool. Because they're not like RPGs, so if you were to play through The Witcher 1, 2, and 3, you're looking at, like, you know, 500 hours of gameplay, probably, aren't you?
Yeah.
See, there's a few games that I've completed multiple times. One of them actually being Chrono Trigger.
Yeah.
I've done that a few times. It's an old game for the Mega Drive, which in the UK is supposed to be called Crusader the Century, but I got some weird kind of NTSC PAL hybrid. So it's the PAL version of the game, but with the American name, which is Solio. And I've completed that, God, more times than I can count.
A Link to the Past on the SNES, I played that through a number of times. All the Mario games, I played NES games, all the Nintendo games, I've hammered a number of times. But
Ocarina of Time, I played that a lot, to the end.
I played that twice through, because it's quite long, that game, getting everything anyway. Super Metroid, God, I've literally got every single item possible in that game, and I've only 99%ed it. It gives you a percentage at the end, and I'm sure it's bugged because I've got everything. I've even went into one of them completion magazine things, and I was like, "Well, what am I missing?" And nope, nothing. Got everything. Annoying.
Did you get the swimsuit?
The swimsuit. That's what happens at the end of the second one, isn't it?
Can't remember now. I know there's one of them where you get a swimsuit which you stand in it at the end.
Oh no, that's just what happens at the end of 2.
Isn't that the first one that she does that in?
No, actually it might be Super Metroid that it happens in. But it's the end of the game and you basically your suit disintegrates and she's just in a swimsuit. It might be the first game actually, because that's the whole reveal,
the
that he's a she, you know? You don't think that she is.
I think it's the first one. I think it's like, because you find out at the end, it's like a famous thing in video games. Anyway.
I'm pretty sure it's the first one. I'll think about it. I can't think of any more off the top of my head, but I'm sure there's plenty that I've played multiple times, but I don't tend to do that much. Really. Not these days. Half-Life, play that through. God knows how many times. And Half-Life.
Yeah, I've played Half-Life 2. I've played that through at least 3 times, I think. To completion. Portal 2,
played a few times. All right, I've played quite a lot all the way through a few times, but yeah, whatever. Right, I think we're finished. I think we've finished our game list, haven't we?
Yeah.
Well, we are not quite finished yet, so let's skip the Way of the Exploding list, unless anybody has any specific ideas they want to
We kind of just did a little mini one there without even talking about it. We just listed a load of replayable games.
Yeah. All right. Well, do you want to talk about replay games a little bit more then, if we're going to do that, or should we just knock that on the head there?
I think I used to do it more. There are certain games in my collection now that I will go back and replay, because I like to go back and do it as a thing. Like, I'll happily go back and play Ocarina of Time, like, right now, or Legacy of Kain, or whatever. But I used to have on the Mega Drive, when I used to have Mega Drive, the Sonic 3 and Knuckles expansion thing that you could get. And you had different save slots, and the different characters were Sonic on his own, Sonic with Tails, Tails and Knuckles. And I had four slots, and I had each one of those combinations 100% completed with all the Chaos Emeralds and, like, Hyper Sonic and Hyper Tails and all that unlocked. And I'd just be like, yeah.
I have no complete.
Can't even screenshot it and upload it to Facebook, can you?
No, because I don't have Mega Drive anymore. I don't even have it anymore.
Because Facebook didn't even exist back then. No one cared. No one apart from you.
I smashed through that game, obviously, at least four times, if not more.
I think I'm very guilty of starting a game. Like, again, Sonic, I've played through the first few levels of that numerous times, but I always get to a point where I'm just like, I've had enough. I can't be asked to complete this game again.
Yeah, the problem with the original Sonic is you couldn't save it.
Could you not?
You had to do it in Sonic 1 and 2.
You had to do it.
And Sonic 2. Wow. You had to do it in one sitting or not at all. That was it. That's all there is to it. Ah, the good old days.
Yeah.
Because there weren't even passwords, because a lot of games back in the day used to give you a password for a level.
Yeah.
Didn't have that on the Mega Drive. Not to start off with. I think later games might have had it. And some games had save function on the cartridge.
The only thing could do was do the level select cheat.
Yes.
Up, down, down, whatever it was, A, B, C, whatever.
It was up, down, right, up, down, down, left, right, start, I think it was. It was pretty simple on the first game.
Up, down, left, right, A and start.
A and start. That rings bells.
Wasn't that on Sonic 1 to get the levels?
It might have been. And then it was different on Sonic 2.
Yeah.
But there was also the debug cheat, which I used to love.
Yeah.
And the debug cheat where you could change your icon into a ring or any of the enemies from the level and just make these like ridiculous little mini levels to yourself that were just stupid.
Speaking
Give yourself
of making,
like 100 rings in 1 second.
Speaking of making levels, Mario Maker is being quite popular these days.
It must be fairly
recently out.
I was watching a couple of Game Grumps episodes of that. And it looks really cool, actually. I have to say, for one of those games that's a bit like a Little Big Planet one, it looks like it's a lot of fun. It's very, because the content creation, a lot of creators have just made levels that are just brutally hard, but they are beatable.
Yeah, I've seen some videos off Reddit where, I mean, they all call it the most impossible level, but there's some way you look and you just think, that's got to be a bot.
Well, they complete it. Yeah.
Because like the throwing things in advance and then jumping off things, you know, bouncing, doing like really unique jumps and then coming across that thing they threw, like, you know, like seven moves later, bouncing off that to get to something else. It's either a hell of a lot of time invested, or they're using some type of cheat.
I mean, I'm pretty good at Super Mario. I'm not that good. I'm pretty good at timing things, and you know, very the 2D games at least. Anyway, the 3D games I'm not as good at, but. I know what you mean. I've seen a few of them myself. Not the Super Mario Maker, but the original Super Mario games. And I don't know. I think there's people that just plow hours into it.
Yeah. If they're a level maker themselves, they might have a bit more of an understanding of how you can manipulate those things. I haven't seen any of the really high level, so I've just seen little bits and pieces. But it looks like it's quite good fun. I think you're fun amongst your friends as well. If you've got a few friends who are into it, you make levels for each other just to piss each other off.
There's one I've just posted into Twitch there, which is the one I saw on Reddit that's supposed to be the hardest, called the Pit of Panga.
Pit of Panga.
Yeah. And it's...
What the...
Exactly. If he is doing that, then, you know, kudos.
He is. He's dying, so he's got to be.
He's died once.
Oh, I wish I could show this on the stream. Unfortunately, I can't. What's he doing? Oh, I see. What?
Only gets worse as well.
Right, I'm going to watch that later because it's not very good viewing, that, is it? It was sat there going...
I don't have Twitch open, so I can't watch it anyway. I might watch it later.
I'll paste it in Skype for you, Sam. There you go.
Cool. All right, I'll check it out later.
Okay, so let's move on then to the news. Let's talk about the thing that Corpse is wittering on about in chat. EGX. I was asked earlier on if I was going to go to EGX, which is this weekend coming up, so no is the answer, unfortunately. I was actually going to wait until Stee and Lou were back from holiday and ask them if they fancied going. But I just think it's a bit short notice now, isn't it?
What's EGX?
EGX is a gaming convention in Birmingham, and it's the big one, well, the big one up north at least, or Midlands rather, for England.
I thought I'd heard of it before, so that's... Is it always in Birmingham?
EGX is a huge gaming convention. Like a huge. We should really know about it and cover it. To be fair, it's like a PAX or a Gamescom con type thing. I would be up for going to it one year with you guys if you fancied it.
Yeah, there's enough notice. I'd be up for it.
I said I was. If I you guys went on holiday, I'd have asked you if you last week or whatever. But maybe that Birmingham's. Wasn't short
Birmingham's not that even that far for me to get to. I could get there. No worries.
Oh, cool.
It's simple for me to get there, but it's just a short notice. I'm already away this weekend.
It's too short notice. No, we're not going to EGX, but we will endeavour to next year. Let's make that a date, eh, guys? Let's try and get together and get on it. So, other news. Witcher 3 DLC, Hearts of Stone, is coming out on the 31st of October, which we've just briefly covered. It looks quite interesting. As I said, I'm not sure I'm going to bother because Metal Gear, because Fallout 4, because Mad Max.
You will bother.
I don't know if I will, you know. I think I've had me fill now.
You will.
I don't need any more. What's it? It's just going to be more of the same, isn't it? And I've had me fill. I've had me fill of Witcher 3. It was awesome. It was very good.
Remember these words, Sam.
You don't know. You can't say what the future holds, can you?
No, I can't, but I will. No, I'm not going to. I bet you I don't, to be fair. Unless it comes out, like, unless it's on a sale or it's cheap, I probably won't bother.
I have to say, I didn't get any of the Skyrim DLC because I'd played so much of the main game. I was like, don't really need any more of this. Well, so I didn't.
You know what my problem is? My problem is I get the DLC. I've got all the Skyrim DLC. I never played it. I've got out the Fallout 3. Got all the Fallout 3 DLC. Never played it. I got them all as part of Game of the Year editions that were cheap somewhere, and I just sat there doing nothing. Dragon Age. All of the Dragon Age Origins and Dragon Age... No, not 2. Dragon Age Origins DLC. Haven't played it.
Have you played Inquisition yet, the new one? The newest one?
No. It is, again, on my list, but I don't think I'll ever play that now because there's so many other...
People have said that one's great.
They've also slated it as well.
Have they? Oh, well, okay.
No, it does look... The people who are into Dragon Age do tend to like Inquisition. They didn't like 2, but I enjoyed 2. So... It's just... There's so many games. And I'm at the moment, I said, I'm actually starting to wind up my game development again as well, so I don't want to have too many games to play. Because I need to start concentrating on putting some effort in, the spare time effort into my game as well again. Well, in fact, not spare time, hopefully main weekly time, you know.
Yeah, I'm quite happy at the minute with only having kind of one game draw my attention, which is like Mad Max at the minute. And I'd say that I'm probably about 2/3 of the way through that.
Yeah.
So that might fall in quite nicely for Fallout 4.
It may do, and Metal Gear the same for me, because I'm about 1/3 of the way through at the moment, and hopefully, what are we on? September, October, November. November, isn't it, Fallout 4? Yeah.
10th of November, I think it is. It's in my head. Something like that.
I thought it was the 11th, but it's
maybe
November.
It is. It's around that time, anyway.
But yeah, so I reckon that'll be... that'll be my next game, but I don't know. There's so many others. I've actually started to try and play the games in my Steam list. That's hence why I've started to, you know, I got Among the Sleep, for example. I've had that for a while, and I'm going through them slowly. I had a bit of a stint a few weeks back. I don't think you were on the show, Steve, and played maybe about 6 or 7 games, and some of them I would play again, others I'm a little bit like, what's the point? So I've just uninstalled them.
Yeah, there's some games that you buy on a whim, and you just kind of realise that, yeah, maybe it's because of the mood you were in, but you're never going to play them.
Yeah. And there's a game... Sorry.
I was going to say, there's a few that I've kind of... if you buy games from certain websites that we won't mention the name of, there's some arms offer you you can get a random CD key for...
Yeah, never bothered with that.
I've done it once, and I have got like a really random game. And, you know, it's not terrible, but it's got nothing to draw me to it either.
I just remembered, actually, Wut sent me a key for Rocket League. And we were talking about that a few weeks ago, and it's one of those... It's basically Carball.
Yeah.
But we were talking about it a few weeks ago. I think, again, you weren't on the show, Steve, but Lou is very much, it's just Carball. There's no point in playing it. It's going to be rubbish. But everyone was raving about it, and probably still are to an extent, I imagine.
Well, the thing is with like Rocket League is that it's got a big multiplayer following, and a lot of people that we used to play games with online are playing that at the moment.
Yeah, I imagine, yeah. But so, I don't particularly care that much about that kind of thing. I mean, I play it. I'll have a go of it with you guys, but...
For me, it's more of a kind of like a LAN thing.
Yeah. I definitely want to play it at some point with you guys and see if we like it, because we may love it, but I just have a feeling it's going to be quite samey. I just don't see the longevity in it, you know?
Unless you're playing clan matches in a league or something, then I think you're right, it will just get quite samey.
And totally fuck those days right off. Yeah. Can't be asked for that anymore.
Too much.
Prison Architect leaves early access. I thought this is the news of the century, and I was considering keeping this news until Lou's here so he could go all high-pitched and all amazed about it and rant off about how Introversion Software never actually release a game. But they've done it. Well done, guys. Well done.
So it's taken them how many years?
Did it say 6 years or something? Like
6
that?
Years in pre-release.
I can't remember exactly. Anyway, let's have a look at the link.
How much is it selling for?
Well, I got it for about £20, but I think you can get it for cheaper than that.
Ooh. Well, you bought the full version for £20.
Yeah, I bought the early access version for about £16 back then. After 3 years of early access, we're finally able to confirm our launch date. I think it's a good thing, because I can finally play the single player version, you know, the story mode of it, which has been broken every single time I've tried to play it. So I'll play that, see what that's about, and then probably put it down for another year and then maybe go back into it and get addicted for another 2 months. And then
it's one of those games where you just kind of play and fit and start, isn't it? Like you'll just get an urge and you'll just want to build a massive prison,
and then I'll be up till 2 in the fucking morning. And I did it a few weeks ago, 2 in the morning, sat there building a prison and going, oh god, they need some toilets, oh god, that guy's been like naughty, I better build an execution chamber and burn him.
Yeah, that shower needs to be wider.
Yeah. Yeah, oh, that there needs to be some greenery around that. Oh, I need to make some money in that case. There's actually a checkbox in it now that allows you to give yourself infinite money instead of cheating.
Yeah, like, I play sandbox mode.
Yeah that's it.
But for me, as soon as you've kind of built the prison, I lose interest. It's the actual building of the prison
the management side isn't so interesting, but I'm with you there, yeah. But that doesn't matter, as long as you're getting that injury. I've got way more than my money's worth out of that game.
Oh, yeah.
And it was an early access, you know? As much as it may never have been finished, which it now is, I got a lot from it, so I'm happy. 6th of October, anyway, so what? That's about a week and a half, 2 weeks away. Angry Birds.
2 weeks yesterday.
Angry Birds the movie, first trailer. Yay.
I just spotted this just because it's shit. I actually watched the trailer and I was like, this looks like one of those, you know, those just like shit CGI films where all the characters have the same fucking 6 facial expressions for every different emotion, the same tired ass jokes. Like, it just looks wank.
Sony Pictures Imageworks.
And it's also coming out after the Angry Birds fad has had its day. So when this film comes out, are there really going to be that many people that are really bothered?
Yeah.
I think even the, will be.
You reckon even the kids that were bumming it a couple of years ago They've probably moved on to something else now.
I know, but they're not the kind of retro for them.
Peter Dinklage is playing a bird named Mighty Eagle.
Is he? Good for him.
Josh Gad.
There's some reasonable talent involved in the voice cast. I'm not going to deny that, but it still. If you watch the trailer, it still feels like one of those like shitty animated movies.
Tony Hale's in it.
All those shitty animated films continue to come out and continue to make money.
They do. They
do. It's just something that I think that parents can think, oh, we can take the kids to, you know, the cinema and keep them quiet for a couple of hours.
Fucking shut them up.
Which is a tangential issue for me, because I think that there are good kids media that the parents should actually spend a bit of time researching and get the kids to watch that rather than Madagascar 17 or whatever. I'm not slagging Madagascar. I've never even seen Madagascar or Ice Age, but they do churn out fucking
Ice Age is quite funny. I've seen the first two. I don't know how many more there are.
There's like seven of them out there now. Something, I don't know.
Ice Age, the melting.
Yeah, I was going to say Ice Age, not icy at all age.
I think one of them's Slush called age. The Big Freeze, actually, I think.
Oh, I don't know.
Not the melting. Global warming.
It's not turning my hopes for the first legitimately good video game movie on, should we say. Whereas a Minecraft movie at least is an ongoing juggernaut of success that I think people are going to be excited. I don't know how you make a movie out of it, but people are going to be up for that one. I don't really see that much interest in this one.
Good video game movies.
We were talking about them a while back, and I'm sure I saw one recently, and I'm trying to think for the life of me.
There are some good video game related ones, like Indie Game the Movie's good, but I'm talking about like an adaptation.
It's not a movie though, that's just a documentary.
Yeah, but an adaptation of a game.
What did you say there, Steve?
Doom.
Not seen
Final Fantasy VII Advent Children.
I like both the Final Fantasy films, to be fair.
Yeah, no, I think I was expecting something different from The Spirits Within.
But I saw a bit of Final Fantasy.
Rewatched it a couple of years later. I did actually enjoy it.
Final Fantasy VII Advent Children is only going to be for people who enjoyed that game. It's not.
Oh yeah.
It's not like.
There's absolutely no way you can enter that film without knowing everything you possibly can about Final Fantasy VII.
But a film, that's not the point of what a piece of cinema should be. A film should stand on its own. You shouldn't need to have played the game to understand the film.
I wasn't disagreeing.
I'm not saying that it can't be a great film if you're a fan. But I mean, like, the sort of main. There's not been a mainstream, big, heavy hitter, like, movie that's of a game that everyone's gone, wow, that was fucking cool. Like, you could say, you know, you've had one for, like, you know, Batman's had a couple of really genuinely good movies. There hasn't been anything that's been genuinely really good. Like, Mortal Kombat's entertaining, but it's not a good film in like, cinematic terms, really. It's very silly.
There's a movie reviewer that, like, dissects movies, and he's done a series of, like, piss takes of reviews. In one of them, he compares Mortal Kombat to The Way of the Dragon, and he dissects it piece by piece and says it's basically the same movie.
The Way of the Dragon or the Enter the Dragon?
Enter the Dragon.
Enter the Dragon.
Because Enter the Dragon, it is, actually, now that I'm thinking about it.
I can't remember. I know Enter the Dragon quite well, but I can't remember the Mortal Kombat movie at all.
What's he called? I want to look that up.
Does he go into an underground cavern and get trapped in a little fight arena and get gassed?
They arrive on an island. There's the, you know, the Asian fighting guy who meets with a white Caucasian guy. They have a banquet in the honor where they meet some of the fighters. The biggest fighter, which is Goro Mortal Kombat's called Bolo.
Bolo, yeah.
Yeah. And it ends with, you know, your Bruce Lee, Liu Kang character beating
the old guy
impaling him on spikes. And so he breaks it down. I mean, there's obviously more to it than that, but it's just quite a section. I'll find a link for you, Sam.
Yeah, it sounds like the kind of thing I would enjoy.
But I still stand by Doom as being a decent video.
I haven't seen that one, so I can't criticise. It's got very mixed reviews, generally.
It does,
And the Prince of Persia film was, again, quite enjoyable, but not great. It was like, fun, but not great.
I'm sure there's something I saw recently.
Well, they've released a couple of images, I think, of Michael Fassbender in Assassin's Creed sort of outfit. Who knows? That could lend itself well to a cinematic kind of thing, potentially. I always thought the story in the first couple of games was quite intriguing. Yeah, Chris just can't. He's just belligerent sighing. It's not an argument. It's just belligerent sighing.
I can't count anything.
Even if
that's the best film on the planet, I cannot possibly acknowledge that it is anywhere near decent.
Even you said you really liked Assassin's Creed 4, which is quite recent.
Look, I really enjoyed the story of Assassin's Creed. I thought that it was brilliant. They're just money-grabbing, greedy fuckholes. That's what they are, and that's what drives me up the wall. I know it's they're making money to pay millions of employees and all that kind of rubbish, but just lay off. Move on to something else. Just lay off with Assassin's Creed fucking 574 Assassin's Creed pirate hookers or some bollocks. Just no.
So you won't be in the midnight showing for that film then?
Yeah.
Wearing your Altair outfit.
With my AK-47.
Oh god. Let's not get onto that subject.
Yeah, let's not get onto that. No, I can't acknowledge Ubisoft anymore, I'm sorry. I've had enough of them, and I keep looking at games and thinking, "Oh, that looks good," and then looking to see if it's Ubisoft because it's got that similar kind of Ubisoft mechanic in it.
Yeah,
and I've been quite lucky so far. There's been no games since I declared my undying love for Ubisoft a few months back that have appealed to me too much. So I haven't yet had to break that rule of I am boycotting them for the rest of my life. But I think I probably will have to at some point, and it's a bit upsetting. But has anyone played the or is it out yet, in fact, the new, speaking of Ubisoft, is the new South Park out yet?
No, it's not out till next year.
The
Fractured Butthole. So stupid.
It better be better.
It makes me laugh. But every time I say it out loud, I laugh.
I can't play it because it's Ubisoft.
I'll play it for you.
Yeah.
I'm gonna be getting that. I really enjoyed the first one. I'm gonna be getting the second one.
I really enjoyed it to a point, and it just got a little bit samey and like, oh, I can't be fucked anymore.
But it was fun though. Even if the gameplay wasn't amazing, I enjoyed every second because it was funny consistently all the way to the end of the game.
Yeah, and kind of like the little kind of, you know, like my hat tips to old, like, other RPGs. And when you go to Canada and it's all 8-bit, and
every time I found a Pokemon and it went, Pokemon! I laughed every time it did that.
I laughed so at a lot. The game was good, I said, but the gameplay was tosh at the end of it. But it was just like being in South Park, and that was a good thing about it.
The gameplay wasn't terrible, it was just bland, but the world was really cool. It was South Park.
Yeah.
You know. Anyway.
So, anything else anyone wants to talk about, or shall we close the show?
No, I'm good for this week.
Well, thank you very much for everybody who watched today. Sorry for the technical issues, and hopefully you have been able to see us since my XSplit froze again. Hopefully next time XSplit will not be freezing like it is, and I'm about to show you a few more things because I think people like that. I think it's a bit more interactive, isn't it? And thank you. We'll catch you again next time we're on. Don't know if it'll be next week or the week after or maybe even next month. But thanks for coming, and we'll see you later. Bye-bye.
Bye.